Hey guys, I hope you all are in your pink of health. And today I'm here with the final version of the arches of foot. In this, we are going to discuss regarding the clinical relevance of other arches of foot. So, as per part of revision, there are the total four types of arches: two longitudinal and the two transverse. In the two longitudinal, namely medial longitudinal arch and the lateral longitudinal arch, and the two transverse arch, there is an anterior transverse arch and the posterior transverse arch. Now, regarding this clinical anatomy, there are five types of deformities we are going to discuss over here. First is flat foot, that is pes planus. Second is high arch foot, that is pes cavus. Third is club foot. Fourth is hallux valgus and the hamartome. So over here, I am trying to cover the all the three foots, that is hind foot, mid foot, and forefoot. So first deformity is flat foot. So in that, it is a commonest problem of the all the individuals, and it is occurs because of the failure of this medial longitudinal arch, and it is also called as the pes planus. So you can see the foot how it is look like from the medial side, and it is generally observed from the medial side. You can see the flattening of this medial longitudinal arch, right? Next, mechanism behind this flat foot is due to the prolonged standing, there is an overstretching of this plantar aponeurosis, right? And due to this overstretching of the plantar aponeurosis, the talus will lose their support. And due to that, the head of the talus should downward between the calcaneum and the navicular. And as a result, medial longitudinal arch lost, right? And then due to this, there is a flat foot occur. And in this flat foot, you can see this, there is a lateral deviation of the foot, right? As you can see this, navicular, right? So there is a navicular tuberosity. So this is the drop of the navicular bone. Fine? Okay. Now, which are the impacts of the flat foot? So first impact is the individual typically has a backward shuffling pace as a result of loss of spring in the foot. Second is it makes the foot more likely to trauma because of reduction of the shock absorbing function. Third is the compression of the nerve and the vessels of the soleus as a result of reduction of the concavity of the sole. And the third is the compaction of communication between the medial and lateral plantar nerves results in the neuralgic pain in the forefoot. And this neuralgic pain is called as metatarsalgia. Now, next is high arch foot, and this is high arch foot is called as pes cavus deformity. Cavus is also meaning of high arch. It is the exaggeration of the longitudinal arch of the foot, and the main reason behind is contracture at the transverse tarsal joint. The person with a high arch foot typically walks like with the dorsiflexion of the metatarsophalangeal joint and the plantar flexion of the interphalangeal joints of the toes. Now, looking at this difference between these three patterns of the foot, the first one is the normal foot that you can see, right? The bony alignments and the aponeurosis as well. Then in the high arch, it is you can see there is a curvature from the lower downside, and in the pes planus or the flat foot, it is a flattened, right? Now you can also judge it from their footprints, right? This is a normal one, high arch one, and the pes planus, that is flattening. And you can also look or the observe it from the posterior view of the lower leg and the foot. So in the normal one, you can see the straight line. So it is in with the calcaneum, right? In the high arch one, it is the slightly inverted, and over here in the flat foot, it is inverted. Fine. Next, the club foot. Now, clubfoot is present congenitally and it is also present acquired as well. So, it is typically present in the babies, right? Who are having this kind of deformities. Not all the babies, okay? So, there are the five types of clubfoots. So, in these five deformities, generally we can enlist then talipes equinus, talipes calcaneus, talipes varus, talipes valgus, and the last one is talipo equinus varus. That is a typical clubfoot. Okay. Now, next, over here, I am going to describe based on their foot positions, and based on that, there's in gait patterns. So, first is talipes equinus. Now, in the talipes equinus, you can see in this picture, the typical foot position is plantar flexion. And due to this plantar flexion, patients walks on the toes with the heel lifted. And it is usually look like in horse walking, right? Next is talipes calcaneus. Now, talipes calcaneus, the typical foot position is in the dorsiflexion. And due to this dorsiflexion, patients always walks on the heel with forefoot lifted. Next is talipes varus. In this talipes varus, patients always walks with inverted and adducted foot. And due to this, the walking pattern is on the outer border of the foot. Right? Next is talipes valgus. In this, the foot position is inverted and abducted. And due to this, patients always walks on the inner border of the foot. Next, the last one is talipes equinus. In this talipes equinus, patients always having the foot position is inverted, adducted, and plantar flex. So it is in the mixed deformity of talipes equinus and talipes varus. So due to this, patients always have a tendency to walk on the edge of the foot. And this is a typical picture of the clubfoot, that is talipes equinus deformity. Okay? Next. Hallux valgus. So hallux valgus is, as the hallux valgus name suggests, there is a valgus deformity in the first toe. So deviation of the big toes towards laterally at the metatarsophalangeal joint. It is usually because of continuous wearing of pointed shoes with the high heels. Due to this, there is a head of the very first metatarsal bone becomes notable and rubs on the shoes, and as a result of this, there is a creation of the protective adventitious bursa referred as a bunion on the medial side of the big toe. So, person who are walking high heels, they have some in the prolonged courses, they have their bunion formation at the first metatarsal, so along with this hallux valgus deformity. And it is generally present in the person with the rheumatoid arthritis as well. And even it is present in the old person, more in the septuagenarians or the hexagenarians. Next is the hammertoe. So this deformity is the deformity of the phalanx or the fingers, you can say. In this deformity, there is an hyperextension of the metatarsophalangeal joint and the distal interphalangeal joints, right? And hyperflexion of the proximal interphalangeal joint, right? So this is look like as an hammer. And thus it is called as hammertoe. And this generally affect the second and third toe. And it is eventually also affect in the older population in the little finger or the last finger of the toe. Okay. So this is all about the description of the deformities present in the foot. Thank you for watching. Like, share, and subscribe to my channel. Stay home, stay safe.